everybody. My name is Kalle Slaap, and I'm a watchmaker here in the Netherlands. And the question we get most often here by students is, where do I start assembling? Because disassembly of a watch isn't that difficult, but assembly, putting it back together, might be. Simple fact, most of the watches are broken when they arrive at the watchmaker. So if you disassemble the watch and assemble it exactly how it was, the watch will probably still be broken. So the first lesson every student gets here, we put a watch movement together how it should, not how it was. Because you can never trust a previous watchmaker. You have to decide if it's okay or not. And luckily, I would like to show you a bit of logic in a watch movement. And that is simple. For the last 200 years, watch movements hardly ever changed. There was innovation in materials used, in complications, but the basics are exactly the same for 200 years. There's simply a balance wheel, an escapement, four wheels, and a main barrel. That's it. Here, balance wheel, escapement, the gear train, four wheels, and the main barrel. And as long as you can see the logic, it makes life so much easier. I went to school, well, started at electrical engineering, and I hated the school in Alkmaar. The teachers weren't inspired, except for two maybe. It was just horrible. But I learned an electronic way of thinking, and that is very systematic. And that was so helpful in my further career and as a watchmaker. And I apply that logic in watchmaking. Well, I hated the school so much that with my best friend, Rob, a landscape gardener, who had a huge supply of Roundup, that was the plant-killing agent, that at 2 a.m., middle of the night, we went to school, and when I passed my exams, and we sprayed letters, huge letters, 4 by 3 meters, klaar, in the school lawn. And klaar means, well, finished, but in Dutch also, fed up. We thought it was very funny, and I still think it is very funny. But that's the way of what I learned about the school. The only positive thing is have a systematic way of working and do the in-between tests so we know the whole process is tested even when the process isn't finished yet. It's working, it's working, it's working, it's not working. Okay, the problem should be there. And the same logic as in electronics is going to apply it here by thinking in function groups. You can see the balance wheel consists of many parts. Shock system, balance staff, balance ring, the balance spring, even the double roller with the impulse stone, many parts, balance cock, the end shake, if that's okay. We see the balance wheel as one function group, and we are going to test it like one function group. I'll show you in a minute. It all makes sense. Then the gear train is one function group, even though there are many jewels, many gears, pinions, pivots. You can see it as one function group. Then the main barrel, where all the power comes from, is again one function group with the main barrel, with the arbor, with the spring, with the barrel, the lid, all the stuff, one function group. And if you see that all the huge amount of parts in a watch movement, but if you can think of it as a combination of parts doing one thing, it makes life so much easier. And when you assemble a watch movement, you know upfront it is going to work, but because you've done all the in-between tests. And I'm going to show you that now. Well, the watch is disassembled, and I can imagine the amount of parts can be overwhelming. This is a very simple Unitas 6497, not too many parts, but still. Where do you start? And how do you make sure, more important, how do you make sure all the defects you found during assembly? Because there probably will be defects because we are watchmaking, repairing. Try to see all the parts as function group. One is here. That's the balance wheel with all the parts attached to it. One function group. One function group, pretty small but very important, is the escapement. Here with the Swiss lever escapement. All this here is winding the main barrel. And this bit here is the gear train. For 200 years, everything's still the same. To explain a bit more about the function group, I'm going to use some watchmaker magic, clear my desk, and show you a bit more about function group and the systematic way of thinking. Here it comes. Well, that's magic, isn't it? I want to show you a process way of thinking, and it's completely applicable for watchmaking. So it may sound childish, but bear with me. We're going to make a cup of tea. Again, bear with me, but it will make sense. I want you to think in function groups. To make a cup of tea, you need water, a boiler, a tea bag, berries from Ireland, of course, and a glass. I will show you in a moment that a watch movement is just about the same, but I want you to think in a particular way in function groups. Well, this is a clear liquid, but I'm not sure if it's water. It might be vinegar. So, tested it. Nice water, no problem. We don't have to think about the liquid anymore because we tested it and it's nice water. For the boiler, we pour the water in, and if we plug it in and the water becomes bubbly and steam is coming out, we know the function group water boiler is working perfectly. We don't have to check the plug, we don't have to check the cord, we don't have to check the warming elements. It is working. So if the function group water boiler is okay and the water is boiling, we don't have to check every single part, just the function group water boiler is functioning okay. And after that, we just pour it in, add the tea bag, and we have tea. Function group glass, well, we know there's no moisture around it, so it isn't broke. The edges are okay. We don't have to check every single part because the function group glass is holding the hot liquid. And that is what it should do. So with every single step, we do in between tests and back to the watch movement, and I'll show you if you think in function groups, it will make life so much easier. I want to show you where to start. And again, I only do suggestions. If you're an experienced watchmaker and you've got your own way of working and been doing that for 10, 20, 30 years, excellent, excellent. I will never tell you to do any otherwise. But if you're a hobby watchmaker, if you're less experienced, this might give you a system to work from. And for me, it's a first time right system, because the in-between tests of all function groups will make sure that all defects, because usually there are more than one, if you found one defect, never stop looking for the next one, because a watch is worn, a watch is dropped on a marble floor, anything can happen. So first thing I like to do is the function group. Well, of course, you have cleaned with some pegboot all the jewels. You've cleaned it in alcohol, but be careful for the pellet fork and the impulse stone. The shellac will dissolve in alcohol. Maybe you used some, in America they called it lighter fluid, but I think the European name is naphtha. You can use that. But as long as every part is clean and checked. Checked if the pivots are okay. Then you clean it with some pegwood. More on that in watchmaker tips. And then the first thing I do, shock system is oiled. And then I place the balance wheel on the complete empty main plate. Usually you think the first thing you take out and the last thing you put in is the balance wheel, because it's so fragile. But if we place the balance wheel on a completely empty main plate, you've got a complete view around it, and I'll show you the first test. See this as the function group balance wheel. Complete empty main plate, nothing there, just the balance wheel. And now the first test. Just do this. First thing you see is the main spring, the balance spring is centered. The amount of space between the windings there is just about the same as there. It's moving freely. You see? No effort whatsoever. You put it like this. You put it like this. It's still moving freely. So now you're testing the pivots, the jewels, the shock system. If a pivot is bent, it will never run so freely. If the balance spring isn't straight like this, and that's why I love testing it on an empty main plate, because you can see the balance spring from all sides. Nothing is interfering with the function group balance wheel. And now you see it's moving freely, nice and clean, in different positions, even dial up. If this is moving freely, the pivots are okay, shock system is okay, the end shake is okay, you know there's nothing wrong with the balance wheel, so you don't have to think about it. This is an in-between test. You take it out and you know function group balance wheel is okay. I hope that makes sense, because it is important. And this way, with the in-between tests, it is first time right. If there's anything wrong with the balance wheel, there's no need to continue assembly of a watch movement, because the fault will still be there, the defect. So now we know there is no defect in this function group. We put it away and we don't have to think about it again. First test done. I hope that makes sense.